Now we come to the next sutta, number 100, Sangarava Sutta, to Sangarava. Thus have I heard, on one occasion the Blessed One was wandering in the Kosalan country with a large Sangha of monks. Now on that occasion a Brahmin woman named Dhananjani was staying at Chandala Kappa, having full confidence in the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha. At one time she stumbled and on recovering her balance exclaimed three times, Honor to the Blessed One, Arahant Sammasambuddha. That means Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhasa three times. At the time, there was a Brahmin student named Sangarava staying at Chandala Kappa. He was a master of the three Vedas with their vocabularies, liturgy, phonology and etymology, and the histories as the fifth. Skilled in philology and grammar, he was fully versed in natural philosophy and in the marks of a great man. Having heard the Brahmin student woman, Dhananjani, utter those words, he said to her, This Brahmin woman, Dhananjani, must be disgraced and degraded, since when there are Brahmins around, she praises the ball-pated recluse. Stop here for a moment. So you see, because of jealousy, a lot of Brahmins, they didn't like the Buddha. Buddha was famous, had a lot of followers. Even some of the Brahmins left the religion to become Buddhists under the Buddha, and many of them also renounced. So this fellow, Sangarava, he's a very learned Brahmin, stock description of a learned Brahmin, master of the three Vedas with their vocabularies, etc. And this woman said, My dear sir, you do not know the virtue and wisdom of the Blessed One. If you knew that Blessed One's virtue and wisdom, my dear sir, you would never think of abusing and reviling him. Then, madam, inform me when the recluse Gotama comes to Chandala Kappa. Yes, dear sir, the Brahmin woman Dhananjani replied. Then, after wandering by stages in the Kosalan country, the Blessed One eventually arrived at Chandala Kappa. There in Chandala Kappa, the Blessed One lived in the mango grove, belonging to the Brahmins of the Todea clan. The Brahmin woman, Dhananjani, heard that the Blessed One had arrived. So she went to the Brahmin student, Sangarava, and told him, My dear sir, the Blessed One has arrived in Chandala Kappa and is living here in Chandala Kappa in the mango grove, belonging to the Brahmins of the Todea clan. Now is the time, dear sir, to do as you think fit. Yes, madam, he replied. Then he went to the Blessed One and exchanged greetings with him. When this courteous and amiable talk was finished, he sat down at one side and said, Master Gotama, there are some recluses and Brahmins who claim to teach the fundamentals of the holy life. After having reached the consummation and perfection of direct knowledge here and now, where among these recluses and Brahmins does Master Gotama stand? Stop here for a moment. So this fellow is quite impudent. He's got the gall to ask the Buddha, some recluses and Brahmins claim they have reached the consummation and perfection of direct knowledge here now. That means they claim to become enlightened. So are you enlightened? He's asking the Buddha. The Buddha said, Bharadvaja, I say that there is a diversity among those recluses and Brahmins who claim to teach the fundamentals of the holy life. After having reached the consummation and perfection of direct knowledge here and now, there are some recluses and Brahmins who are traditionalists, who on the basis of oral tradition claim to teach the fundamentals of the holy life. After having reached the consummation and perfection of direct knowledge here and now, such are the Brahmins of the three Vedas. There are some recluses and Brahmins who entirely on the basis of mere faith claim to teach the fundamentals of the holy life after having reached the consummation and perfection of direct knowledge. Such are the reasoners and investigators. There are some recluses and Brahmins who, having directly known the Dhamma for themselves, among things not heard before, claim to teach the fundamentals of the holy life, after having reached the consummation and perfection of direct knowledge. I, Bharadvaja, am one of those recluses and Brahmins who, having directly known the Dhamma for themselves, among things not heard before, claim to teach the fundamentals of the holy life, after having reached the consummation and perfection of direct knowledge. Stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha says, among those ascetics, recluses who claim to be enlightened, some are traditionalists. On the basis of oral tradition, they claim to have perfected themselves. The second one is based on faith, and they claim to have perfected the holy life. And the third one, they directly know for themselves. So the Buddha says he is in the third category, having directly known the Dhamma, he claims enlightenment. As to how I am one of those recluses and Brahmins, that may be understood in the following way. Here, Bharadvaja, before my enlightenment, while I was still only an unenlightened bodhisattva, I considered thus. Household life is crowded and dusty. Life gone forth is wide open. It is not easy while living in a home to lead the holy life, utterly perfect and pure as a polished shell. Suppose I shave off my hair and beard, put on the yellow robe and go forth from the home life into homelessness. Later, Bharadvaja was still young. So here, the following description is found as in Sutta 26, where the Buddha said, in front of his parents, as they wept, he left the home life, shaved off his hair, cut off his hair, put on the yellow robe and left the home. Then after that, there's a description of the three similes, as in Sutta 36, about the three types of wood. One is wet and sappy, and lying in wet ground. The second one is wet wood, wet and sappy wood, lying on. The first one is wet and sappy and lying on wet ground. The second one is wet and sappy but lying on dry ground. The third one is dry wood, lying on dry ground. And the Buddha says only the third type you can make a fire. So in the same way, somebody who has this desire for lust and desire for sensual pleasures internally, and not withdrawn from, mentally and bodily withdrawn from sensual pleasures, cannot attain enlightenment. And then how the five monks left him. And then after that, the five disciples left him because he started to take one meal a day. And then after that, how he struggled and attained enlightenment. And this was said, the Brahmin student Sangharava said to the Blessed One, Master Gotama's striving was unfaltering. Master Gotama's striving was that of a true man, as it should be for an Arahant Samasambuddha. But how is it, Master Gotama? Are there gods? Let's stop it for a moment. So here, after the Buddha described how the Buddha struggled to attain enlightenment, then this Sangharava, I guess he believed the Buddha, that the Buddha was truly enlightened. Now he's asking whether there are gods. And the Buddha said, it is known to me to be the case, Bharadvaja, that there are gods. But how is this, Master Gotama, that when you are asked, are there gods, you say, it is known to me to be the case, Bharadvaja, that there are gods. If that is so, isn't what you say empty and false? Stop here for a moment. So here when the Buddha said, it is known to me that there are gods, he thought the Buddha probably heard it from somebody. So that's why the Buddha says it's known to him. The Buddha did not say that I know directly that there are gods. So if that is the case, he says that means what you said earlier about enlightenment, all that is empty and false. Then the Buddha said, Bharadvaja, when one is asked, are there gods? Whether one answers, there are gods, or it is known to me to be the case that there are gods, a wise man can draw the definite conclusion that there are gods. But why didn't Master Gotama answer me in the first way? It is widely accepted in the world, Bharadvaja, that there are gods. When this was said, the Brahmin student Sangharava said to the Blessed One, Magnificent Master Gotama, Magnificent Master Gotama. Master Gotama has made the Dhamma clear in many ways, as though he were turning upright what had been overturned, revealing what was hidden, showing the way to one who was lost, or holding up a lamp in the dark for those with eyesight to see forms. I go to Master Gotama for refuge, and to the Dhamma, and to the Sangha of monks. Let Master Gotama remember me as a lay follower who has gone to him for refuge for life. The end of the sutta. So here, this is another case of a Brahmin who is quite arrogant about his caste, comes to the Buddha and then is converted by the Buddha and becomes a Buddhist. The next sutta is quite long, so I think I do it tomorrow. We can stop here. And if you have anything to discuss, we can discuss. So we have finished 100 suttas. That's very good. We have 52 more. Hope we can finish it in a month's time. Which one? That's quite correct lah. To a certain extent, we find when we compare the Majjhima Nikaya and the Digha Nikaya, Majjhima Nikaya has certain suttas which are very practical for a monk lah, cultivating the holy life lah. In that sense, it's quite advanced lah for quite advanced suttas lah. But not all. There are some like this. The last few we read is just about the Brahmins who come to argue with the Buddha. But earlier we did come across a certain that had a lot of Dhamma content. In the Digha Nikaya, you also have some which have good Dhamma content. But because Digha Nikaya, there are only 34 suttas. So in the 34, some of them don't have so much Dhamma content lah. So Digha Nikaya is easier to go through lah in that sense. That's why it's, maybe that's why people say it's more suitable for external ascetics or for lay people. Okay, if there's nothing, we stop here.